All right. Now, for those of you who weren't here this morning, this is actually kind of a continuation from this morning's sermon. It's a separate enough topic, but they go hand in hand. This morning I preached on the Reformed Catholic Church. I know we had talked about this before. We're kind of talking about church history and how things came to be and everything else. And I preached against the Reformed Catholic Church, because that's all it is. It's just Catholic light. It's just a watered down version of Catholicism. All these Reformed churches that are out there, Presbyterians and the Lutherans and all these different things. And I covered a lot of that stuff in this morning's sermon. But what I left out, because it deserves an entire sermon dedicated to itself, is the subject of Calvinism. This teaching that is named after John Calvin. John Calvin was one of the forefathers of the Protestant Reformation, if that's what you want to call it. He was very influential, and he has this doctrine in regards to salvation, and that is named after him. And I said this morning, but if you're following a doctrine, like a biblical, what do you consider a biblical truth, and it's just named after a man, big red flag should be going off in your head, because this is God's word. If some man just came up with some kind of a doctrine, did it come from God or did it come from that man? This, I guarantee you, came from this man. This doctrine is not of God. This doctrine is very wicked. And there's basically 5 points of Calvinism that is taught. And they have it separated into 5 things, and there's this cute little acronym for it. It's called TULIP. And that's to help you to remember what the 5 aspects of their doctrine entail. It's each letter represents one of their points. And we are against all 5 points. People like to will try to think in terms of this, like today politically, people say, well, you're either Democrat or Republican. Like, well, no, I'm neither, right? But people have a hard time dealing with any other choices other than just one or two, right? Coke or Pepsi. They both have high fructose corn syrup. I don't want either, right? And what they'll do with Calvinism, they'll say, well, you're either Calvinist or Arminianist. And these are the 2 options that you have. And we're neither. The Arminians believe you could lose your salvation. We don't believe that. But we're going to get into the Calvinism. You'll understand exactly why we're not Calvinist tonight. Now, the reason why this goes so hand in hand with the Reformed churches is that I'm pretty sure just about every single Reformed church believes in Calvinist doctrine. I mean, John Calvin was part of the Reformation of the Catholic Church. And this doctrine they taught is why, this is what I grew up with. This is what I was taught in the Presbyterian church I went to. And people will there's kind of this scale of how much they believe this doctrine. And what I mean by that is that there's this concept that people have called hyper-Calvinism versus just regular Calvinism. And I'll be honest with you, if you take the doctrine to the logical end, if you just basically take it for what it's saying, you have to be hyper-Calvinist. You have to accept that. Otherwise, it doesn't stand up. It doesn't hold up at all. It's although that kind of goes with the way that the Reformed churches deal with everything. They take this stuff from the Catholic Church and they just water it down, and they kind of stand on the fence and they speak out of both sides of their mouths with all of their doctrines. We saw that this morning with baptism. They do this infant baptism where the Catholic Church will straight up tell you, you got to be baptized in order to be saved. You got to be baptized to go to heaven. It's one of the 7 sacraments. You got to keep those in order to make it. Catholic Church, they won't hide about that. I mean, they'll tell you that's what they believe. But these Reformed churches, they say, well, you don't have to be baptized to go to heaven, but they still baptize babies. An infant, they're kind of doing like both things. It's really bizarre, but I'm not going to get in. I'm not going to re-preach what I preached this morning. One of the main goals and focuses for tonight's sermon in understanding Calvinism and Calvinist doctrine, we don't typically want to spend very much time learning false doctrine. There's so many false doctrines out there. We don't want to just spend all of our time learning other people's false doctrine. But the reason why this particular one is so important is because it's so widespread, and it's in regards to salvation, and you need to understand what people may believe if they say they go to a Lutheran church, if they say they go to a Presbyterian church when you're out soul winning, because it's one of the trickiest ones. You could talk to someone at the door and they'll tell you, someone who believes in Calvinist doctrine will tell you, if you ask them, why are you going to heaven? They'll tell you, I believe in Christ. Many of them will say that. They'll just say, I believe. And they'll say, and you say, well, you know, what about, you know, doing good works or whatever? And they'll say, no, it's just faith. And they'll be solid about that. They'll say, no, it's not of works. It's just by faith. So that's the right answer. Of course, there's nothing wrong with that answer. That's true. Salvation by grace through faith. Amen. But if we're not careful about being able to ask a lot of the right questions, you can walk away from someone thinking they're saved when they're not. And again, I went over this a little bit this morning too about really getting to the heart of the matter and what people believe for salvation. And the reason why Calvinism is so wicked and evil, one of the reasons is because people can tell you a right answer even though their faith isn't right. And you'll understand why when we start going through these 5 points. Now, I'll read this for you. This is kind of a broad overview of Calvinism. And I got a lot of my information from, like, I forgot the name of the website. It's like reformed.org or something. It's some main website for Reformed theology. And in this morning's sermon, there's the Westminster Creed or their doctoral statement, and this is from like hundreds of years ago, from the times of the Reformation, and this is something that Reformed churches generally all subscribe to and adhere to. And I got this statement regarding Calvinism. It's, you know, it's funny because when you go on this website, and I'll tell you this too, my personal experience with people who believe in Calvinism have a tendency to be very intelligent, at least with the wisdom of this world, very smart, you know, kind of thinkers. You know, people who, they're not stupid. They're not just ignorant, right? I mean, they're ignorant of God's truth, but they're people who have a tendency to think too much. I think they overthink and overanalyze the Bible and God's word and don't accept the simplicity of the gospel. And they really complicate it to the point to where it's like, what are you talking about? But and it just gets twisted. But I'll read this for you. It says, according to Calvinism, it says, salvation is accomplished by the almighty power of the triune God. The Father chose a people. The Son died for them. The Holy Spirit makes Christ's death effective by bringing the elect to faith and repentance, thereby causing them to willingly obey the gospel. The entire process, election, redemption, and regeneration, is the work of God and is by grace alone. Thus, God, not man, determines who will be the recipients of the gift of salvation. Now, if you didn't catch that, I'll paraphrase it for you. What they're saying is that God determines who will get saved and who doesn't. They consider putting your faith on Christ, just faith itself, believing, is a gift from God. You don't have the power. You don't have the free will to actually, for yourself, put your faith on Christ to save you. They say that itself is only given to you by God, and God does not give that to everybody. They say God picks and chooses. That's what they're, so when they talk about the elect, they talk about people he's chosen, saying, okay, I'm choosing you. I'm going to give you this grace to believe on Jesus Christ and to get saved, but I'm not going to give it to this person over here. This person does not, I'm not giving them that gift. And because God doesn't give that person that gift, they are destined and determined to go to hell no matter what, and they can't do anything about it. This is what Calvinism teaches, and this is why it's so wicked. They believe in this God, and what they do is they call it sovereignty. They say, well, God is almighty and in charge of everything, and who are you to question God? When God is just up there, he's saying, well, saved, not saved, not saved, not saved. You're going to hell, you're going to hell. Can't do anything about it. I'm just, because I feel like it, I'm just saying that you're going to go to hell. But I love you. And they'll say, well, God's not a respecter of persons, so it's just, who knows why God does it? It's just his grace. And if you happen to be one of the lucky ones that God just chosen, you got the winning lotto ticket that you were called, then good for you. And that's in a nutshell, that's what they believe. And it's a very disturbing doctrine. So I'm going to read for you here, because they call it providence. They call it God's ability to control everything. And God's up there kind of just making sure that everything happens the way that he wants it to happen. Now, what they do is they'll take some truths and they twist it and they confuse it. Because a lot of the things that I'll be reading tonight, because I have a lot of statements from their, you know, from this site that explains Calvinism and stuff, you'll hear a lot of things that's like, I believe that, I believe that, I believe that, but then I don't believe that. And what we do, do we believe God is all-powerful and almighty? Yeah. God has the power to do anything. But there are a few limitations that God even puts on himself. And this is what they don't seem to understand. For example, the Bible says that God cannot lie. But God's word says that. Now, Calvinists might have a problem with this. I don't know what their response to this is, to this argument. I haven't seen it anywhere. I haven't really looked it up or cared to. But they're saying, because God's all-powerful, he essentially causes everything to happen. And just says, well, for whatever reason, this is the way he wants it to be, so that's the way it will be no matter what. And they have this idea that his hands are involved in everything, instead of God choosing to not get involved with absolutely everything that goes on in this world. Sometimes does he step in? Of course he does. Sure, that's evident. We see God stepping into situations. We see God, you know, leading the children of Israel out and parting the Red Sea and everything else. God's involved in that. But I don't think that God is doing everything. And as far as God's all-powerfulness, well, he put a limitation on himself that he can't lie. You say, well, I thought God can do anything. Well, no. Actually, I mean, he can't lie. And that's part of his holiness. Otherwise, he wouldn't be holy. But I'll read this to you about what they believe with his providence. They say, the almighty power, unsearchable wisdom, and infinite goodness of God so far manifest themselves in his providence that it extends itself even to the first fall and all other sins of angels and men. So, and again, a lot of times the words that they use, you have to be looking at it. And like when I was reading it, sometimes you have to read it a couple times to really get what they're saying and to see, wait a minute, that doesn't make any sense. So what they say is his providence, you know, his unsearchable wisdom, his power, it extends itself even to the first fall. The first fall, he's referring to Adam and Eve. When they sin in the Garden of Eden, they're saying that because of his power, his providence extends even to that first fall. That he basically made that to happen because he had this whole plan for things to happen. Now, the biggest problem that Calvinists have is that they confuse a foreknowledge with making people do things and forcing people to do things. And the reason why the Bible says that Christ is the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world, that is because God understood and he knew what was going to happen in advance. But just because God knows something doesn't mean he makes it to happen. And it's this concept of the free will, which Martin Luther is wrong about, John Calvin is wrong about, and the Protestant churches, the Reformation is wrong about. They don't believe we truly have a free will. They don't, because they believe that because of Adam's sin, you are born automatically a sinner, and because you're a sinner, because you have this sin, because you're corrupted, you do not have the capability of having that free will to accept Christ as your Savior. It has to be given to you. You do not have that free will to do so. And ultimately, it's God who's the one who picks and chooses, and God's the one who decides all of these things. So they don't truly believe in the free will of man. They believe it's your will is limited. And it's controlled by God. And that is just patently false. So they say here it extends itself even to the first fall and all other sins of angels and men. And that not by a bare permission. So they're saying it's not that he just allows it. Bare permission meaning that God simply allows it to happen. Which I believe, we believe that, that, you know, God's not controlling the sin, yet he is allowing it to happen. It's, he's not stepping in every instance because he's given to man free will to do things. And sometimes man will choose to do things that will harm another person. Maybe a believer, maybe someone who's born again. And they'll choose to do something that's going to inflict harm on this other person. And sometimes God doesn't step in to do anything about it. He allows it to happen. Now, allowing something to happen is not the same as causing it to happen. Understanding just that God has given us a will is an amazing thing in and of itself, that he's given us the ability, that he doesn't want to make all the decisions for us. He says, no, I've given that to you. You make these decisions. Which we don't have free will if he's forcing everything to happen a certain way. But so they believe that even sin, the sins of angels and men, is not just because God is permitting, it's because God's basically making it happen, which is making God the author of sin. But then they'll come back here and you'll notice they speak out of both sides of their mouths all the time because they make these statements to say it's not just by bare permission and it extends itself even to the first fall, even to these sins of men and angels. It says, but such as has joined with it a most wise and powerful bounding and otherwise ordering and governing of them in a manifold dispensation to his own holy ends, yet so as the sinfulness thereof proceeds only from the creature and not from God, who being most holy and righteous, neither is nor can be the author or approver of sin. They just made him the author of sin in earlier in the statement, and then they come out and say, well, but he's not the author of sin. And this is how all of their doctrine works. They'll be saying one thing, and then they'll be saying something completely different. And they're preaching confusion, and they're preaching lies. Now, the Bible says this. In Jeremiah chapter 32, verse 35, it says, and they built the high places of Baal, which are in the valley of the son of Hinnom, to cause their sons and their daughters to pass through the fire unto Moloch. He's going, look, people were doing this. They were sacrificing their own children, causing them to pass through the fire unto a false god, unto a devil, Molech. And he says, which I commanded them not, neither came it into my mind that they should do this abomination to cause Judah to sin. God's saying, the thought never once even occurred to me that these people should sacrifice their children in the fire unto some devil. God is not the author of that sin. They got that last part right, but what they said in the first part makes him the author, makes him the person, you know, the responsible party for this sin. They'll say that somehow these children being sacrificed in the fire is God's will, because God makes sure that his will is always done, no matter what, because he has this providence. And that's not what the Bible teaches. The Bible says God's like, I didn't even think about that. That thought never even crossed my mind. So it did not come from God. One thing that's kind of interesting I noted when I was going through the doctrinal statement is they actually believe in reprobates, but I never ever heard that once taught before. They actually have a pretty close good understanding about people whom God has rejected, and it's in their statement of faith, but not one time have I ever heard anything mentioned about that in the years that I grew up in the Presbyterian church. Now, I know that, granted, that's just my one church and my one experience that I've been to, but I thought it was kind of funny that they do have some belief on this idea of reprobation. But I'm not going to get into that tonight. We got plenty of other things to look at. Now, they believe that even the act of believing on Christ is not something you can do on your own. So when we go out and we knock on people's doors and we're trying to persuade them, we're trying to give them the gospel, we're trying to show them, and they're understanding this and they're seeing it and they're reconciling it in their mind and they're coming to these conclusions that if they do put their faith in Christ, what the Calvinist teaches is that, yeah, they didn't do that. The only reason they could even do that is because God gave them the gift to do that. Specifically because God chose them. that belief is a gift by God. And here's the way that they say it. And in regarding saving faith, they say the grace of faith whereby the elect are enabled to believe to the saving of their souls is the work of the Spirit of Christ in their hearts and is ordinarily wrought by the ministry of the word, by which also and by the administration of the sacraments and prayer it is increased and strengthened. And they also say this, that it's requiring of them faith in him that they may be saved, and promising to give unto all those that are ordained unto eternal life his Holy Spirit, to make them willing and able to believe. They're saying, unless God makes you able, capable of believing, you cannot believe. This is what they believe, that it's just impossible for you to believe unless it's given to you by God. Now we're going to go into this I don't think acronym is the right word, but I forgot what the word is when you use one letter for each of the words, TULIP. So the T in TULIP stands for total depravity. Okay, total depravity. Now, they claim depravity is you know, being depraved, is like just being really wicked or vile, right? Just being completely, we would probably think of it as reprobate, okay? That would be someone that we would call depraved. They say that total depravity doesn't mean that you're that wicked of a person of just like, you know, the scum of the earth. They mean it just, I'll read for you what they say. They say total depravity is probably the most misunderstood tenet of Calvinism. When Calvinists speak of humans as totally depraved, they are making an extensive rather than an intensive statement. The effect of the fall upon man is that sin has extended to every part of his personality, his thinking, his emotions, and his will. Not necessarily that he is intensely sinful, but that sin has extended to his entire being, meaning that we are sinful from head to toe. That we have no way, and that's why they think that there's no way of even believing. Because we are so sinful that it's impossible, because of the sin nature, we have zero way of even being able to put our faith in Christ. And this comes from the fallacy of original sin. And I'll touch on this briefly because I preached an entire sermon about original sin a few months ago in September. And they believe that we are born depraved. We are born completely sinful because of Adam's transgression, because of what Adam did in the Garden of Eden. We are automatically born sinners. And we'll look at Romans 5 real quick just to answer this this total depravity, which is not true. The Bible says in Romans 5:12, wherefore as by one man sin entered into the world, and death by sin, and so death passed upon all men, for that all have sinned. So the reason why death passed upon all men is because everybody has sinned. For until the law, sin was in the world, but sin is not imputed when there is no law. Nevertheless, death reigned from Adam to Moses, even over them that had not sinned after the similitude of Adam's transgression, who is the figure of him that was to come. But not as the offense, so also as the free gift. For if through the offense of one many be dead, much more the grace of God and the gift by grace, which is by one man, Jesus Christ, hath abounded unto many. And not as it was by one that sinned, so is the gift. For the judgment was by one to condemnation, but the free gift is of many offenses unto justification. For if by one man's offense death reigned by one, much more they which receive abundance of grace and of the gift of righteousness shall reign in life by one, Jesus Christ. Therefore, as by the offense of one judgment came upon all men to condemnation, even so, by the righteousness of one the free gift came upon all men unto justification of life. For as by one man's disobedience many were made sinners, so by the obedience of one shall many be made righteous. And they'll look at this verse and say, see, because of Adam's transgression, death came upon all. And they'll say, because of his sin, everybody is condemned. But that's not what this is saying. In the context, when you look at it, it's equating what Adam did in bringing sin into the world and then what Christ did in bringing life into the world. So when it says that as by the offense of one, judgment came upon all men to condemnation, but then it says even so by the righteousness of one, the free gift came upon all men unto justification of life. So what this is saying is that are all men going to heaven? Because God died, is every single person going to heaven? You would have to believe that in order to believe that because Adam sinned, everybody is going to hell. Do you see what I mean? If because this is the way the Bible is equating it, that if Jesus Christ died for all, then all are made righteous. And because Adam sinned, then all are condemned to death. No, Adam sinned, now we were past a sinful nature, right? And death was brought into the world, and sin was brought into the world, but his sin does not condemn me to hell. When I was born, I was not condemned to hell because Adam sinned in the Garden of Eden. And neither were you, and neither was anybody. Seth, Cain, Abel, none of them were condemned because of Adam's sin. They were not going, God did not already pronounce them guilty when they were in Eve's womb because of Adam's sin. That's false, but that's what they believe about this original sin concept and this total depravity of just being extremely wicked. And this simply is not true. We choose to believe just as much as we choose to sin. Right? It's our choice. If you're going to be held responsible for your sins, if God sends you hell, it's because you've sinned. It's not because your father sinned or your grandfather sinned or Adam sinned. It's because you sinned. It's because you've broken God's laws and you did not accept the atonement for your sins through Jesus Christ. That's the reason why. It has nothing to do with what anyone else did. It's what you do. God holds you personally responsible because he's given you free will, because you have the ability to make these choices. And this is where they're wrong on that first point. The second point, the U. So T is total depravity. U is unconditional election. They say there's no conditions to being saved, to being elected, to being chosen by God. Unconditional. We believe the exact, all of these, we believe the exact opposite. Unconditional election? No, it's actually conditional. Because whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. That's a condition. That's saying if you believe, then you are not, then you are saved. If you don't believe, then you are not saved. Those are conditional statements. I know a lot about these as a programmer. You have if, then statements, if, then else. If you're a believer, you're saved. If not, you're not saved. There's a condition to it. But here's what they say about unconditional election. It says unconditional election is a doctrine which states that God chose those whom he was pleased to bring to a knowledge of himself. So you can't even have a knowledge of God unless God chose you to come to a knowledge of him. Not based upon any merit shown by the object of his grace, and not based upon his looking forward to discover who would accept the offer of the gospel, God has elected, based solely upon the counsel of his own will, some for glory and others for damnation. He has done this act before the foundations of the world. This doctrine does not rule out, however, man's responsibility to believe in the redeeming work of God the Son. Scripture presents a tension between God's sovereignty and salvation and man's responsibility to believe, which it does not try to resolve. They're saying there's this tension. Like they're already admitting a contradiction. They call it a tension. It's a contradiction in their own beliefs of God saying, you need to believe on Christ to be saved. While they're saying, well, God already chose. From the foundation of the world, God already picked who's going to be saved. It's already done, settled. You still need to believe, though. Well, how can I? Well, I mean, God's got to let me do it. God's got to force me to do it. He's got to will me to do it. According to them, according to their doctrine. They say both are true. To deny man's responsibility is to affirm an unbiblical hyper-Calvinism. This is where they're condemning hyper-Calvinism. It says, and to deny God's sovereignty is to affirm an unbiblical Arminianism. And remember what I said earlier, we're neither. We're not Arminian. We're not Calvinist. And we don't have to choose between those two choices. Here's what they say about effectual calling. They say, all those whom God hath predestinated unto life, and those only he is pleased in his appointed time effectually to call. Now, this was really interesting because this, all their web of lies of their heresy intermingle. They're all kind of related. So remember what I said about original sin and being totally depraved because of Adam's sin. Well, the first thing that I would think of is, well, what about babies? What about infants? What about little children? Right? I mean, if they're automatically sinners, how do I get, you know, the baby that's in Leslie's womb, how do I get that baby to believe on Christ? Because they have to do that in order to be saved. That baby's being born is in sin right now, according to these guys. And that's why you have infant baptism. Because they think that there's some type of redeeming quality, some type of regeneration that happens with baptism. And that's why the Catholic Church does it. That's why anybody would do it, is because they're worried about their children having original sin and going to hell. But it says here, this is what they say in their statements, and this is just wicked. They say, elect infants dying in infancy are regenerated and saved by Christ through the Spirit, who works when and where and how he pleases. So also are all other elect persons who are incapable of being outwardly called by the ministry of the word. So they're saying here, and what they don't do is mention the unelected infants, right? They just say, oh yeah, but the elected, don't worry, the elected infants, they're going to heaven. They've got that ticket. But didn't they just say that you can't separate God's will and from your requiring to put your faith in God? Like they said, you had to do that. But I guess for infants, they get a pass. But only if they're elect. But what they're saying by saying it's the elect infants, they're saying that there are infants that are just go straight to hell because God didn't choose them. What type of sick, perverted, twisted God do these people believe in to say that an infant is just going to burn in hell forever if they were to die in a car accident? Right? Or... you know, my 1 year old back there. You know, if she were to some tragedy were to happen and she were to die, to believe that, well, God just didn't choose her. It's disgusting, it's wickedness. I can't believe people would ever subscribe to a teaching like this. It's not found in the Bible. Here's what we see in the Bible. Joshua chapter 24. Because this is their doctrine that completely eliminates your free will. Is what they're doing. They're saying God chooses. Joshua 24:14 says, now therefore fear the Lord and serve him in sincerity and in truth. And put away the gods which your fathers have served on the other side of the flood and in Egypt, and serve ye the Lord. And if it seem evil unto you to serve the Lord, choose you this day whom ye will serve. Whether the gods which your fathers served that were on the other side of the flood, or the gods of the Amorites in whose land ye dwell. But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Joshua is saying, through the Holy Spirit, you choose. Choose for yourself. Who are you going to serve? I can't choose. No one said that. No one said, I can't choose. God has to choose it for me. Because I'm incapable of making a choice. That's what they believe. Proverbs 1:28 says, then shall they call upon me, but I will not answer. They shall seek me early, but they shall not find me. For that they hated knowledge and did not choose the fear of the Lord. So now God's talking about people. I'm not going to answer them. I'm not going to talk to them. Why am I not going to do that? Because they didn't choose the fear of the Lord. He doesn't say, because I didn't give them the opportunity or the ability to fear me, which is what Calvinists believe. He says, no, they didn't choose it. They didn't choose to fear me, so I'm not going to listen to them when their trouble comes. I'm going to laugh at their calamity, he says. I'm going to mock when their fear cometh. This is Bible. This is Scripture. This is what God says. It would make no sense for him to even say these words if people were incapable of making a choice. Revelation 22:17 says, and the Spirit and the Bride say, come. And let him that heareth say, come. And let him that is athirst come. And whosoever will, let him take the water of life freely. Anybody that wants to, it's your will. Whoever wants to, whoever's will is to get saved, hey, let them take of the water of life freely. Anybody that wants to. This is what the Bible says. Romans 7. Romans 7:14 says, "For we know that the law is spiritual, but I am carnal, sold under sin. For that which I do, I allow not. For that I would, that do I not. But what I hate, that do I. If then I do that which I would not, I consent unto the law that is good. Now then is no more I that do it, but sin that dwelleth in me. For I know that in me, that is in my flesh, dwelleth no good thing. For to will is present with me." He's saying, my will to choose, I have that will. It's present with me. He's talking about, obviously we're in this sinful flesh. He's like, I'm in this body. There's no good thing in my body. It's wicked. He says, for the will is present with me, but how to perform that which is good, I find not. He's saying, I have the will. I have the ability to make a choice. But I'm having a problem finding out how to do it. And he says, the good that I want to do, I don't do. I do not. But the evil which I would not, that I do. Now, if I do that I would not, it is no more I that do it, but sin that dwelleth in me. I find then a law, that when I would do good, evil is present with me. For I delight in the law of God after the inward man, but I see another law in my members, warring against the law of my mind, and bringing me into captivity to the law of sin, which is in my members. So he's differentiating between his mind and his flesh. He says there's a war going on. I want to do what's right here, and my body's saying, no, I don't want you to do what's wrong. This whole time he's describing his free will, his ability to make choices. He never once mentions that God is really behind the scenes making him decide certain things to do, and now you're going to be in the flesh, and now you're going to be in the spirit, and God's really the one controlling that. No, he has that free will. He says, "Oh, wretched man that I am, who shall deliver me from the body of this death? I thank God through Jesus Christ our Lord. So then with the mind, I myself serve the law of God, but with the flesh, the law of sin." Now, we started off in 1 Timothy chapter 2 because this is a real powerful verse and one that you're going to want to keep highlighted or remembered if you ever run across somebody who believes in this Calvinist doctrine. Because it's all about not having a will, as I've already been mentioning over and over again. And what they believe also, the next point is going to be limited atonement, that Christ only died for some people. So right now we're on unconditional election, that God just picks and chooses. So God's the one who chooses. And the next point is limited atonement, that God, because God picks and chooses, he didn't die for the people that he didn't choose. He only died for the people that he did choose. And we're going to see a lot of scripture to refute that as well. But in 1 Timothy chapter 2, look at verse number 3. The Bible says, "For this is good and acceptable in the sight of God our Savior, who will have all men to be saved and to come unto the knowledge of the truth." What is that saying? God wants his will. What God's will is that all men would be saved and come unto the knowledge of the truth. That's what God wants. If God wants that, then what kind of God wants everyone to be saved, but then only picks and chooses certain people? It's stupidity. This idea of unconditional election. God only picks and chooses certain people to be saved. He says flat out in 1 Timothy chapter 2, he wants everybody saved. If he only picked certain people, then he doesn't really want everybody saved. That's not what he really truly wants. Because what they're claiming is that God has the power, and this is what God is doing, that he is in control. He is in charge of choosing who gets saved and who doesn't get saved. It's totally up to his will to do that. Well, he just said that he's willing that all men should be saved. That is his will. If that's truly his will, then you can't have this concept of unconditional election. It goes on, it says, "For there is one God and one mediator between God and men, the man Christ Jesus, who gave himself a ransom for all, to be testified in due time." And I'm getting ahead of myself, but it doesn't matter. Limited atonement, where it says that Jesus Christ only died for the elect, for some people. this destroys that again in this one simple verse, which is why we started off reading this chapter. And remember 1 Timothy chapter 2 when you run into Calvinists out soul winning, because it's going to be really important. Hopefully they can, you know, the word of God can break through into their heart to show them the truth about God and about God's will and about the way people get saved, that it's not just all up to God. It's up to us to put our faith in Christ. And that God doesn't force us to do anything as far as believing and not believing is concerned. He has given us that gift of free will, not the gift of being able to believe to only some people. He's given the gift of being able to believe to everybody. 2 Peter 3:9 says, "The Lord is not slack concerning his promise, as some men count slackness, but is long-suffering to usward, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance." God does not want anyone to die. He doesn't want anyone to perish. He wants everybody to come to repentance. He wants everybody to put their faith on him. So, limited atonement, I'm not going to read their thing. It's what I said is true, and I don't need to read everything that they have here to explain that Jesus Christ only died for specific people. If that's the case, then what about John 3:16? Right, the most famous verse in the whole Bible says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life." For God so loved some people? No, the world. That's everybody. God so loved everybody. All people, the whole world, that he gave his only Son. Because God loved everybody, he gave his only Son. Not because he only loved certain people and only chose certain people from the foundation of the world. "I only chose these people. This is who Jesus is dying for." No, he says, "I love everybody and I want everybody to be saved. So I'm going to give my only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, to die on the cross, go to hell and rise again after 3 days to save them from their sins. But it's up to them to choose. It's your choice. It's a free gift. World, here. I want you to have it. I bought it. I paid for it. It's for you. You have to take it. It's your choice." Calvinists will make you think that he goes, "This is for you." And then God comes along and goes and like opens up your hand and then makes you take it. And it's like, you have no control over that. You have no control over accepting or rejecting the gift. It's heresy and it's wicked. And at the heart of it, it's extremely evil and a satanic doctrine. 2 Peter 2:1 says, "But there were false prophets also among the people, even as there shall be false teachers among you, who privily shall bring in damnable heresies, even denying the Lord that bought them, and bring upon themselves swift destruction. Did you catch that? Again, their claim is saying that God chooses and says, okay, these people are saved. Jesus, and they're saying that Jesus Christ did not die for everybody. Limited atonement, that's the L. Jesus Christ's atonement is limited to certain people. If that's the case, in 2 Peter chapter 2, when it's talking about reprobates, it's talking about false prophets, right? It says they were even denying the Lord that bought them. If God bought them, but they're reprobate and they don't believe, and they're false prophets, they're going to go to hell. But it doesn't change the fact that Christ still died for their sins. The difference is that Christ's payment is not imputed unto them. It's not applied to their sins, to their account, because they haven't received him. But he nonetheless still died for them when he died on the cross. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 14 says, "For the love of Christ constraineth us, because we thus judge, that if one died for all, then we're all dead. And that he died for all, that they which live should not henceforth live unto themselves, but unto him which died for them and rose again." Jesus Christ died for all. They'll say, "Oh no, that means all the elect." No, that doesn't say that. You could try to say it means something different, but what it says is that Christ died for all. 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse number 10 says, "For therefore we both labor and suffer reproach, because we trust in the living God, who is the Savior of all men, especially of those that believe." So here we have the verse saying there's all men Everybody, and then there's another group of people that are those that believe. He's saying he's the savior of everybody, but it's especially to those that believe. Why is it special? Because it's imputed unto them. It's imputed unto them for righteousness because their sins are forgiven. Because it's because they've believed, because they've received that gift. But it says he's the savior of all men. He died for everybody's sins. 1 John chapter 2, verse 1, my little children, these things write I unto you that ye sin not. And if any man sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous, and he is the propitiation for our sins, and not for ours only, Calvinist, not for the elect's only, but also for the sins of the whole world. Everybody. This stuff, it's so hard to believe, especially as I mentioned earlier, there are people who seem to be very intelligent. And there's people close in my family that I have a lot of respect for as far as their earthly wisdom and the things that they know, and I could go to them for help with a lot of stuff, and they really just have this good knowledge. They've always been very smart in school and education, and they just know a lot about all these different things. Very intelligent brain, right? When it comes to this world that has bought into this. And we have a mountain of evidence showing, I mean, how can you even read this any other way? The fact that Jesus Christ died for everybody. Yet they can still subscribe to this false doctrine. It boggles my mind that people can be like that. But you know what I think it is? It's their pride has blinded them. It's blinded their eyes to the truth. And I pray to God, especially with this person individual, that God will open up that blindness and help them be able to see the error of this doctrine. If he hasn't already, I don't know. I haven't talked to him in a while regarding this specifically. But let's move on to the next point, the I. We're almost done. We have I and then P. I means irresistible grace. So we have total depravity, unconditional election, limited atonement. Jesus only died for some people. Now we're at irresistible grace. Okay, so what they're saying is that God's grace, when God presents his grace to you, it is irresistible. You cannot do anything to stop it. If God has chosen you, you cannot stop it. There's nothing you can do about it because he's chosen you. And his grace is irresistible. See what the Bible says about that. Acts chapter 6. Turn if you would to Acts. We got a few places in the book of Acts. I'll read for you from 2 Timothy chapter 3. 2 Timothy 3:8 says, now as Jannes and Jambres withstood Moses, so do these also resist the truth. Men of corrupt minds, reprobate concerning the faith. Okay, we see people here resisting the truth. Right? The truth from God's word. They resist it. I thought it was irresistible. Excuse me. Acts chapter 6. Acts chapter 6 verse 10 says, and they were not able to resist the wisdom and the spirit by which he spake. And they suborned men, which said, we have heard him speak blasphemous words against Moses and against God. So, this is the story of Stephen. Remember, Stephen was stoned in the book of Acts. And he is preaching this long sermon to these people. And so here we see, okay, they weren't able to resist the wisdom and the spirit by which he spake. So they're saying irresistible grace. Well, you can't resist that. You're going to get saved. Except these people didn't get saved. They couldn't resist the wisdom. They couldn't resist the spirit. Which means they couldn't refute what he was saying. He was speaking the truth. They had nothing to say against it. But what did they do, though? Instead of getting saved by this irresistible grace, they killed him. They stoned him with stones. Something tells me they were able to resist that grace. Acts 7:51 goes into the same story, and it says, ye stiff-necked and uncircumcised and hardened ears, ye do always resist the Holy Ghost, as your fathers did, so do ye. I thought it was irresistible grace. He's saying that they resist the Holy Ghost. They're resisting the Holy Ghost calling to him. According to Calvinism, that can't happen. It's impossible because it's irresistible grace. And it says in verse 59, and they stoned Stephen, calling upon God and saying, Lord Jesus, receive my spirit. They killed him for it. But somehow we're supposed to believe it's irresistible. No, it is resistible. You can resist the Spirit of God. God has given you free will to make that choice for yourself. Are you going to accept it or not? Are you going to accept his grace, his gracious gift of the, that was paid for by the blood of his son, or are you not? Last point, P in TULIP. P is the perseverance of the saints. And what they mean by perseverance means you're going to persevere. You're going to endure unto the end. You're going to continue to, you know, be repentant, live a good life, or whatever all these different works are that they're trusting in, to say, well, that just proves you're saved because you did all the good things all the way to the end of your life. Now, we believe not in perseverance, but in preservation. We believe in the preservation of the saints. God will preserve you. God has saved you and sealed you, and you are preserved through the Holy Spirit of promise and truth that's in your heart. But it doesn't mean that you are going to always walk in the will of God and do that which is right all the way to the end of your life. Again, because we have free will. Because we can choose, what are we going to do? Are we going to do what's right, or are we going to do what's wrong? And just a few verses to close with. 2 Timothy chapter 2, 2 Timothy chapter 2 verse 10 says, therefore I endure all things for the elect's sakes, that they may also obtain the salvation which is in Christ Jesus with eternal glory. It is a faithful saying, for if we be dead with him, we shall also live with him. If we suffer, we shall also reign with him. If we deny him, he also will deny us. If we believe not, yet he abideth faithful. He cannot deny himself. So, and this is a great verse, 2 Timothy chapter 2, again, another great passage to know, even for people, because you run into people at soul winning, and we always like to give these extreme examples. Like, what if someone were to murder someone and commit suicide and everything? Like, are they going to heaven or hell after they believed in Christ? And, you know, we do that so that people could just fully understand the freeness of the gift, the grace of God. The salvation is 100% paid for. But some people will come and they'll be thinking, it's a really good question. Say, okay, I understand the sin thing, but what if someone stops believing? Because, you know, and all we have to do to be saved is put our faith in Christ, right? That's it. We just have to believe. Believe is what's stressed. Believe is what's important. And people say, well, what if someone doesn't believe? What if someone just says later on, they just say, you know what? I don't believe this anymore. God, I don't believe you anymore. And it's a good question. It still doesn't change the fact that that person received everlasting life and it's eternal and everything else. But this verse is a great verse to show people because it says clearly in the Bible in 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 13, if we believe not, yet he abideth faithful. See, God is faithful. God is the one who promised eternal life. Jesus Christ is the one who paid for your sins. God still, even if you are unfaithful to God, even if you are unfaithful to him and say, you know what, God, I want nothing to do with you, he remains faithful to you, which is another reason why God uses marriage as symbolism for salvation and for the way Christ deals with the church and everything else. Look, God will always be faithful. That's why God hates divorce, because God's there no matter what. God won't divorce you. God is there. And that's why we ought to never get divorced, because it's symbolic of that relationship. But God remains faithful. He cannot deny himself. And once you get saved, you have the Holy Spirit residing inside of you. It's the earnest of the Holy Spirit. You are bought, you are sealed until the day of redemption. And it's not or unless you stop believing. No, he says, even if we believe not. That's preservation. Okay? But it's not perseverance, because it's not persevering if you stop believing. That's not persevering. Yet the Bible says he'll still remain faithful, even if you do. And then we got to think about what my last point will be in, or last scripture reference will be in 1 Kings chapter 11. We're going to look at Solomon. Because how did King Solomon end his life? Did he end it on a high note or on a low note? Did he do that which was right in his life all the way to the end? No. Because, you know, think about how he started. Now, he started very humble, right? He started just asking God. Well, God said, okay, ask what you want and I'll give it to you. He didn't ask for riches. He didn't ask for the life of his enemies. He didn't ask for long life. He didn't ask for those things. He just said, God, I want wisdom. I want to be able to know how I can manage this country and in how I can do things the way that you would have me to do them. That's what Solomon asked for, and God blessed him for that. And Solomon did many great works, and he built the temple, and he lived a good life, and he had all these proverbs and all this stuff, and he had this great judgment that he was able to pass on unto other people. But the end of his life, I would not say that he persevered. Look at 1 Kings chapter 11, verse number 4. We'll see what happens. 1 Kings chapter 11, verse number 4 says, "For it came to pass when Solomon was old, that his wives turned away his heart after other gods. And his heart was not perfect with the Lord his God, as was the heart of David his father." Solomon did not persevere. His heart was turned away. It says, "For Solomon went after Ashtoreth, the goddess of the Zidonians, and after Milcom, the abomination of the Ammonites. And Solomon did evil in the sight of the Lord, and went not fully after the Lord, as did David his father. Then did Solomon build an high place for Chemosh, the abomination of Moab, in the hill that is before Jerusalem, and for Molech, the abomination of the children of Ammon. And likewise did he for all his strange wives, which burnt incense and sacrificed unto their gods. And the Lord was angry with Solomon, because his heart was turned from the Lord God of Israel, which had appeared unto him twice, and had commanded him concerning this thing, that he should not go after other gods. But he kept not that which the Lord commanded." At the end of his life, he did not persevere. He directly went against what God commanded him not to do. He disobeyed God, and he did it anyways. So does that mean Solomon went to hell? No. I mean, oh, must not have ever been saved to begin with, yet he penned down the Proverbs and Ecclesiastes and Song of Solomon for us today. Used of God in that great way, yet, no, apparently he wasn't saved because he didn't persevere. No, he was preserved because his faith was in God. Did he end up his life doing that which is right? No. No. Poor example. And it's a shame. He probably lost the bunch of rewards by doing that. But yet he was still saved, yet so was by fire, according to the Bible. We're preserved by the sealing of the Holy Spirit, but that does not mean we will always walk in the Spirit. It's that if we live in the Spirit, let's also walk in the Spirit. Two separate things. So Calvinism is false. Don't get sucked into that false doctrine. But more importantly, I don't think anyone here is going to get sucked into it. When you talk to people and they say they go to a Presbyterian church, when they say they go to a Lutheran church, because there's quite a few people that go to a Lutheran church out here. And man, for the life of me, Lutherans have been stumping me on how to really approach them with giving them the gospel, because they will give you that right answer about faith, about salvation by faith. And oftentimes, people don't even always know that this doctrine is even called Calvinism. They don't know. They don't know the 5 points of Calvinism or anything like that. They're not that educated in it, but they've been taught falsely still. They've been taught that, you know, and think about this. Okay, a person that believes in this, do you really think that person's saved? That they believe that God is really the one that's choosing it, and that God sends certain people to heaven, certain people to hell, just on his whim, according to his will, and that, you know, we really don't even have the choice to put our faith in him. We have to do it in order to be saved, but it's not even because of us. It's because God gave us that gift, and all these different things. It's a gross distortion of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And even to say that Christ didn't die for everybody. No, the Bible clearly says that Jesus Christ died for everybody. Total depravity, a lie. Unconditional election, a lie. Limited atonement, a lie. Irresistible grace, a lie. Perseverance of the saints, a lie. The whole thing is a lie. And now maybe you understand a little bit better, you can know certain scripture, 1 Timothy 2, 2 Timothy chapter 2, great places to turn to just show people the truth from the Bible about salvation and why that doctrine is just wrong. Let's bow our heads and have a word of prayer. Dear Lord, we thank you so much for your word and for opening up our eyes and enlightening us through your word, dear God, and for that great gift that you've given us, the gift of salvation and just the gift of free will, dear Lord, that you've created us in such a way that you've given us an ability to make choices for ourselves, that you did not make us robots. We're not just your puppets on puppet strings doing everything that it is that you're making us to do, but that you've cut those strings and you've given us this free will to act out in our own life, dear Lord, and ultimately to give you that honor that can only come from somebody who has the will to want to serve you. And that love that we can show to you because we actually choose to listen to you and obey you. And I'm sure that has a lot more meaning for you, God, that when we choose to do those things and to obey you and to love you and to listen to you, than it would if you were just making us to love you, dear God. So we thank you for that great gift. Lord, help us to be able to present the gospel clearly and to not falsely assume that people are saved without really digging into what their beliefs are on salvation. Lord, I pray that you would please strengthen us. And it's in your name we pray. Amen.